Good evening and welcome to the future. It's my very great pleasure to introduce our speakers this evening. The first thing I would like to do, of course, is to recognize that this evening's event is taking place on the unceded territorial lands of the Musqueam Nation. Excuse me. And I'd like to just say, I don't know how many in the audience are familiar with Jas Johal's background and achievements and accomplishments, because in addition to being the senior reporter for Global Television here in Vancouver, he is the former South Asia bureau chief from New. He was operating out of New Delhi as Global's South Asia bureau chief, also the East Asia bureau chief in out of Beijing. He has covered almost every major event coming out of those two areas, the storms that have come out of India and South Asia. He's covered the Talibanization of Pakistan, the tsunami in Japan, the Arab Spring in both Egypt and Libya. And we can see if he brought the crystal from the chandelier from Muammar Gaddafi's palatial residence. I don't know if you... Did you bring that in your pocket tonight?
I was told no props.
No props. Who would tell you no props?
Don't want to be accused of being the Gallagher of journalism.
And it's my very, very great honor to introduce Mr. Sudeep Chakravarti, who is just such an esteemed guest. I'm so pleased that he is able to join the Indian Summer Festival. He began his career early with the Asian Wall Street Journal, and moving from there to the India Today as business editor in 1991, and then joining the India Today group as a business editor, senior editor, executive editor, and finally director of the India Today Conclave, the founding director of the India Today Conclave, which is an amazing international think tank among guests that Mr. Chakravarti has hosted in India at the Conclave, included Al Gore, Bill Clinton, Benazir Bhutto, Bill Gates, and an amazing array of the world's great leaders and great thinkers. Following that, Sudeep has embarked on a career as a novelist and has published a series of books, some being nonfiction and others, as I understand it, Once Upon a Time in Aparanta, and also The Avenue of the Kings and Tin Fish. He is a visiting faculty at the Manipal Institute of Communications, and he is editor-at-large for Rolling Stone magazine, and he is a spectacular thinker, a futurist of enormous note. Please ignore this. I'm going to tell you because you need to know these things. And but most importantly, he is in the finest tradition of public intellectuals, a fierce critic and a passionate advocate of India and the future that we will all share. Thank you. Please welcome Sudeep Chakravarti and Jas Johal.
Thank you, Sandy, and thank you, Suresh, and welcome to the Future Society Dialogue. Thank you for attending tonight's event, and I hope hopefully you've been able to attend some other events with the Indian Summer Festival and a few events coming up in the next few days as well. I was very fortunate to attend the gala opening, and it was a very, very special night at the Dr. Sun Yat-sen Gardens. I had an amazing time, and it gives you a lot of respect for Suresh and Sandy and Laura and many, many other volunteers who put this event together. It's great to have such an event part of Vancouver's cultural calendar. I've always felt between 2000 and 2010 would be the decade of the Indian in British Columbia, but I was ahead, I think, by about 10 years. But this event really sort of showed to me once again that these types of events are so important in regards to dialogue, bringing India to Canada and Canada to India. So congratulations and thank you to all of our volunteers, Suresh, Laura, Sandy, and many, many others as well. So it's a wonderful event. and especially for the fact that we were able, and we're fortunate to bring an esteemed guest like Sudeep Chakravarti. So, sir, thank you very much for coming, and I'm looking forward to tonight's conversation. I don't want this conversation just to be about between myself and Sudeep. I will certainly start off the conversation, we'll talk, and I'll bring up broad themes, but I also want all of you to be involved as well. So think up some questions, and of course, I'm not going to be able to ask everything, so I want you to be involved as well. And as this hour progresses, I will be just lift your hand, and I will point to you, and please ask away. So let's start such a broad theme talking about, say, South Asia and India. Sudeep, perhaps you can just give us a snapshot of where India is and where South Asia is today.
Sure. Do you mind if I walk about a bit, ladies and gentlemen? I'm a sort of an excitable kind of creature. Just a small correction. Can everybody hear me? Okay. I'm no longer the editor at large at Rolling Stone magazine. I'm no longer the editor at large at Rolling Stone magazine. I used to be. I decided that I didn't like them anymore. So, I think that they're writing about the wrong kind of music these days. And I wanted to be the Matt Taibbi of India. They didn't let me, so. Okay. Very happy to be here, etc. We don't have much time, and we have a huge region and a huge sort of ambition to cover as well. So I think I'll try and leave you with a few thoughts. So I'm just going to go blip, blip, blip across South Asia. And forgive me if I'm sounding a bit too sort of fast foodish. But we'll get a little deeper into it as the evening progresses. And I really am looking forward to interacting with all of you. So do keep the questions coming. And Jas, I'm sure will lead us through that. Okay. Vast area, as you can see. Let me just sort of, I love doing this. That's Pakistan. Some of us in India, not quite the people in the Indian Foreign Service, but some of us who are arrogant about what Pakistan has come to be these days, we like to now call it a failed state. I don't think it sounds great for Indians to say it, because we've been fighting with Pakistan for a while now over several disputes, but it has not quite failed. In fact, I have a contrary opinion about Pakistan, that despite the fact that it seems like it's falling apart, that its economy is growing at about 3%, but usually between 2.5 to 3% for the last 5 years or so. This area, we're accused of inciting foment because they do a bit of fomenting in this part of our world. Pakistan is in trouble here. Pakistan is in trouble in Karachi. Pakistan is definitely in trouble in this area, which is the sort of the tribal zone of Pakistan, which is sort of being built as a next Afghanistan, really. And of course, we can't get away from the fact that, today, just a few hours ago, the former president, Mr. Zardari, his bodyguard, his chief of security was killed. I don't know how many of you know this, about 8 hours ago or so. So that's what happens to, that's what happens. The current president, right. Correction. So you have that. Afghanistan, we all know about, and they've just pulled out of their, they've just shut down their embassy in Oman. We know that as well. And in the Gulf. So it's looking a bit tricky over there. Nepal is looking a bit hopeful right now. It's going into its elections on November the 19th. It's going and trying again to hold elections to its constituent assembly, which it has been trying to do for the last several years. It hasn't worked very well, but the conflict has cooled there. As you may know, it used to be a monarchy. Since 2006, it is not so anymore, because there was a Maoist rebellion that sort of went from 0 to 110 years, and from 1996 to 2006, the Maoist rebels were able to come into Kathmandu. The Maoist chief actually became the prime minister of Nepal, so on and so forth, but they haven't yet got their act together as far as writing a new constitution is concerned, and we're all looking at it quite hopefully. It is a deeply troubled country, deeply poor, so much so that it looks to India as a wealthy neighbor, the same way that India, in a way, looks to Canada as a wealthy supporter of its people. You have Bhutan over here, which was sort of people used to joke that it's really like a Indian fief, if you will. Consul General, I beg your forgiveness for saying this, but it is true. Now, what has happened is that in Bhutan, which is actually, it's a country that practices the concept of gross domestic happiness, some of you may, and its key party is actually called the Party of Peace and Prosperity. There you go. It is not actually as peaceful as it used to be, because since it tried to embark on a democracy or a democratic movement in 2008, when the king ceded ground to parliamentary democracy, much to India's concern, Bhutan has been attempting to move a little closer to China. And now in India, we don't like that very much when these things happen. I'm not a spokesperson for the government of India, by the way, and I'll prove it to you through this evening. But anyhow, what has happened is that it has displeased India, and that's one of the things I want to talk about how we create problems for ourselves. You don't have to agree with what I tell you. We can agree to disagree. One of the things that has happened is that displeased with the way that the incumbent government and the prime minister has dealt with India by going closer to China, among other things, breaking away from the Indian control of its foreign policy and reaching out to 27 countries, establishing bilateral relations with 27 countries in the past 3 years or so, 4 years actually. India has, since last week, reduced the subsidy for oil and kerosene and other fuels that it used to supply to Bhutan, escalating the local prices by 100% to 150%. That's led to a lot of bad blood in Bhutan as we speak. And they go to elections on July 13th. And there is a sort of a movement which is sort of anti-India as we speak. And I think we've created from an absolute friend to an iffy friend in our neighborhood. Not a good thing. I'll come to that later. Bangladesh, we know about the two begums that fight, the two ladies who are alternating prime ministers, Sheikh Hasina, who's currently the boss, and Khaleda Zia, who was earlier the prime minister, and will, I think when the incumbency arrives, she might just be the prime minister again. This is actually a surprisingly happy story. I don't know how many of you know, but with all the poverty, and some of us call this the armpit of South Asia because all the cyclones hit it, all the bad things happen in Bangladesh, but it's got its population under control more or less. It's growing at about 1.2% a year. Its economy has been growing at a steady 6% a year. I don't know how many of you know this. Its indices, its human index, indices of human development, for instance, it's in many respects ahead of India, which is a grand thing. It's a hopeful thing that's happening. We have had trouble with Bangladesh in the past. The current government is seen to be friendly towards India for very many reasons, including giving up to India many rebels who had earlier taken sanctuary in the territory of Bangladesh. Then you have the next big thing of the future in the region, Myanmar. The World Economic Forum recently held its regional conference over there. And it's really the next big thing. You folks are in Canada, so you'll appreciate the oil and natural gas phenomenon that Myanmar is now known for. And I'm sure many of your corporations would be heading to Myanmar shortly, if not already set up bases in Yangon. And then you have our sort of sometimes friend, sometimes sort of not friend, just Sri Lanka. A funny story about Sri Lanka. Four people control 80% of Sri Lanka's budget. Do you know this? Okay, the president is a gentleman called, anyone? Mahinda Rajapaksa. Okay, dictator for life, more or less. President of the country and head of state and head of government. He's both head of state and head of government. His brother, Gotabaya Rajapaksa, is the Secretary of Defense. And he's really he's a Minister of the Interior, he's a Minister of Defense, he's everything rolled into one. A third brother, Basil Rajapaksa, used to be the advisor to the president, i.e. his elder brother, and he's now the Minister of Economic Development. And he is, in fact, post-war, post-2009, is, I think, in charge of the single most crucial ministry in Sri Lanka, which deals with reconstruction. A lot of economic activity there. Economic growth has risen from about 2.0 to 3% to approaching 8%. I mean, that's the boom that Sri Lanka is facing. Yet, It's a really a dictatorial kind of situation out there. So I think you folks have to make a choice, those of you who want to put your money where your mouth is, as to whether you want to do business with Sri Lanka or not. I forgot the fourth brother, Chamal Rajapaksa, who's the Speaker of Parliament. So between the four of them, and I'm not bringing up the Rajapaksa sisters, who are married to people like the chairman of their SEC and so on and so forth, I'm not yet talking about the ladies who are married to the Rajapaksa brothers, who have their own empires as well. There's also something called Mihin Lanka Airways. Mihin is a diminutive for Mahinda, which is the name of the president. His brother, who's now the defense secretary, was the chairman earlier. He ran into the ground, and now it's been nationalized. There you go. Maldives is an interesting phenomenon. There was a gentleman called President Nasheed who was quite friendly to India. I think India at this point of time is a bit of a country non grata in the Maldives. And I think our government and our diplomats are working overtime, including a friend of mine from university who led a mission to the Maldives, the capital, Male, about 3 weeks ago, and the president wouldn't meet him. Nobody wanted to meet him, and he just got 5 minutes with the foreign minister. So from a country that helped two presidents prior retain his hold on the country by preventing a coup that wanted to topple him, we flew in our sort of super troop carriers into Male, the capital of the Maldives, and so on and so forth. We've now arrived at a situation where it's a bit tricky for us. And by the way, the United States is moving in big time here. I haven't talked about China yet. We're going to get deeper into it, Jas and I. Jas is a live example of someone who knows China very, 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 very well, far better than I do, by the way. I won't pretend about things that I don't know. What is happening is that the U.S. is trying to work with the Maldives something called they call SOFA, a Status of Forces Agreement, because the U.S. is soon, I think, going to get kicked out of the Diego Garcia region from where they've been staging a lot of their action here and where is there, etc. So they're now trying to talk to the Maldives for setting up a big airbase in around this atoll, absolutely the southernmost atoll, called the Adu atoll, if I'm not wrong. And you might have sort of a new Diego Garcia coming up in the south of the Maldives. There's a lot of trouble about that because Sri Lanka doesn't like it. India certainly doesn't like the idea of it. We have our own issues with America about what we're trying to do with each other. China is trying to come in greatly. We'll talk about that. There's a conventional wisdom that says that the U.S. is now looking at India as a balancing sort of a lever against China. So it's a sort of a interesting time and place in South Asia right now. And of course, I must talk about India, which is my country. And I'm proud of it a lot of the time. I think it's a democracy quite a lot of the time as well. And I just want to leave you with a thought about India. And Sandy described me as a fierce critic of my country. I must also qualify that by saying I absolutely adore my country as well. I love it to death. That's my problem. A grand thing happened with India in 1947, and it was reinforced in 1951. We became independent, and then in 1951, we got this grand constitution, which guaranteed overnight, within seconds, every Indian to be equal in every manner. I think that was a wonderful thing. Everybody could vote. Everybody could vote equally. No one had to work harder in order to vote. All genders were equal. And as in India, as you know, we have a third gender as well. Sorry, kidding. The castes were all made equal. Poor people were made as equal as rich people. And it is an absolutely grand constitution, which is derived from France, which is derived from America, so on and so forth. Unfortunately, the application of the constitutional guarantees have not quite worked out the way that the founding fathers of my country thought they would. The irony being that the founding fathers themselves perpetrated a lot of violent acts in this part of my country, which abuts Myanmar. We call it northeast of India. That's a bureaucratic sort of pomposity, I think. It's, as you can see, it's our far east. It's not really the north. The north is here. And when people of this part, especially here, a state called Nagaland, and to the south of that, this is Manipur. This is Mizoram, which also led a rebellion against the government of India, or the idea of India, if you will, for many, many years. When they decided that they were, as they did not belong to a crown-administered British Empire, as India was, all this was, of course, the Indian Empire. They sort of ran a plebiscite, which is disputed by India, of course, and they posted it to the United Nations, and they said, we are the Naga nation, and we choose to not be part of your nation. We don't want to be part of Pakistan or Myanmar or India. In fact, the current leader of the opposition in Myanmar, Aung San Suu Kyi, her father, General Aung San, actually did a treaty between 1948 and 51, which sort of promised the Nagas of that region very many things and then backtracked from it. So, short story, when the Nagas told our first Prime Minister, Mr. Nehru, Jawaharlal Nehru, that they wanted to be their own nation, I think Mr. Nehru, that's my reading of it, and I think that's one of the causes of problems that we currently face in India, so many simmering negative energies in my part of the world, is because I think we reacted to a lot of things with great, great paranoia. I can imagine why, when I look back now. You had the situation here, and of course, those days, this wasn't Bangladesh, that was East Pakistan, the eastern wing of Pakistan. And again, overnight, a seamless India was divided. So you could go from here to here before 15th of August 1947 without a problem. After 15th of August 1947, or 14th of August, because Pakistan got independence a day before we did, you couldn't any longer do that. You had to go all the way around. So I think it created immediately an alienation, a geographic alienation, and you have this little slim thing, about 45 kilometers, which we call the chicken's neck, that links what the Northeast calls mainland India to the Northeast. So I can imagine why Mr. Nehru would write to his political chiefs in this part, which administered this area, saying that this is not the time for political solution. This is on the record, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not making this up. It is part of the letters which are archived in the Nehru Museum in New Delhi, Nehru Library in New Delhi. And he wrote to his political chief here saying that now's not the time for a political solution, and therefore Mr. Nehru sent in the army. And tens of thousands of people were treated very brutally as the British treated the communists in Malay, as possibly as brutally as the British treated the Boers in South Africa. A similar principle of corralling people to deny the rebels shelter, information, so on and so forth. The concept of the concentration camp actually was developed in South Africa to a great extent. And to an extent, what America did in Vietnam as well, India did in Nagaland and Mizoram, which also went to war with India. I think the problem that we faced is that we forgot to listen. And I think Mr. Nehru and his colleagues were traumatized by the partition of India. They tried very hard to keep India together. As you know, there was enormous amount of bloodshed that created in India and Pakistan. I think everybody was reeling from just coping with that. I don't think they were ready to deal with a further thought of losing more territory. So the whole idea was to ensure, by whatever means at hand, and there were vast means at hand, to ensure that if you had to rape, maim, kill, burn, torture, you did it. You just had to do it. And that bad blood, ladies and gentlemen, continues at a moment when I think that this is the next big geopolitical sweet spot in this part of the world. And look, there's China, there's growing Myanmar, aspirational Bangladesh, and also a very aspirational northeastern India. And of course, we have India, which wants to be at the table of the superpowers of the world. We are the next big thing as well. So you have that. And then, because we forgot to listen, and I think the Punjab problem also happened, or it blew out of proportion because I think people forgot to listen. I think we have another huge issue we have in India right now is a Maoist rebellion in this region. It's a very resource-rich, forested. In this part, you have, possibly outside of Mongolia and parts of China, the greatest concentration of iron ore, coal, and other resources, manganese, zinc, diamond, gold, you name it. In rubies, sapphire, in this part of the world. And here you have a left-wing rebellion which has actually festered for the last more than 40 years. And they call themselves Maoists. And I believe, they have nothing to do with Mao Zedong. They have absolutely nothing to do with Mao Zedong except the top ideologues of the movement who are intellectual, who are well-educated, come from the cities of India. And they're the ones, as leaders have always been, are from the urban areas, but they're leading a group of people who are really looking to protect their livelihoods, they're looking to protect their dignities, they're looking to protect what the Constitution of India has promised them all this while and has not delivered. I've met people. I read again today. Yesterday there was a, what in back home we call an encounter. That's when a police or paramilitary or an army comes face to face with a rebel unit. And they had an encounter. This is Mumbai. The encounter, as it is, took place over here in an area in eastern Maharashtra state. Bombay is the capital of Maharashtra state, where six female Maoist cadres, in India we say cadre and not cadre, as we say in North America, or cuadro for Spanish. We say cadres were killed by the police ladies. One was identified as a 19-year-old who actually escaped home because she wanted to escape being married off to somebody that she didn't want. I mean, it's something as crazy as that. I keep talking about this Maoist poster girl that I have, a lady called Savita Kumari, who is from a state called Jharkhand, which is about, if you fly, it's an hour west of Calcutta, or Kolkata, as we call it now. Savita Kumari was very upset because her sister was raped by a landlord. And she went to the local police station, which is in the rural areas, and said, I would like to file a complaint. And in India, we say we lodge a complaint. There's some peculiarities of language we have. Quite charming, actually. So so she went on behalf of her sister and said that I'd like to lodge a complaint. And they said, the chief of the station said, yes, but if you have sex with me first, we'll take it ahead. So Savita Kumari went to the jungle, very angry, and the Maoists very very happy to have her. And she's still alive the last time I checked. And her quotable quote, which is in my book, may I plug my book? It's called Red Sun. Joking. You don't have to buy it. It's enough that you suffer me talking to you. The quotable quote is, before I die, I would like to kill 100 policemen. Now, this is a girl who wanted to be a school teacher. So I keep talking about the Maoist rebellion from this perspective. I think the root causes of rebellion is a lack of governance or effective governance. It is not a situation about this sort of the now stuffed pedophile in Tiananmen Square, a.k.a. Mao Zedong, mass murderer, so on and so forth. One time great general, rebel leader, but really brought down to earth by incredibly bad miscalculations that he took on behalf of his people. So he's really one of the mass murderers of the world now. But having said that, let me say that it's very little to do with Mao. I think it's to do with what we have promised people and not delivered on them. And the way I see it is that it's a deepening issue, because people like me, and there are tens of millions of us, are direct beneficiaries. I stand before you today as a direct beneficiary of all the good things that India has done for its people. I'm a direct beneficiary of India's liberalization process. Everything I wear is Indian, by the way, including the watch. And it's done wonderful things for us in the cities, many, many of us. I'm told 250 million of us. But what is of great concern, and is that I say this, it's almost like a cliche with me now, is that we haven't invited 800 million or so people. Numbers, ladies and gentlemen, in my country are next to meaningless, because it's to do with, we don't talk about 1 million, and we talk about tens of millions, hundreds of millions, right? So 800 million odd people are not invited to what I call the Great Indian Party. And I think those of us who live in Mumbai, I live in a wonderful place in south of Mumbai called Goa. I do visit. It's sort of the Lotus Eaters Paradise, a bit like Vancouver, I'm told. So And Chennai and Cochin, we miss Bangalore in this map. They'd kill you for that, by the way, guys, the map guys. Jaipur, Delhi, Lucknow, Calcutta, you name it. We forget Ahmedabad, the capital of Gujarat, another interesting province of India. We can talk about that through the evening. I think I call these spaces inland. I mean, these are sort of within our acceptable construct, and we are quite the in people, or so we like to think we are. The rest of India, these vast zones where these rebellions take place and where people like the Maoist rebels feed on these vast pools of negative energy that we are so adept at creating for ourselves. Those areas I like to call outland, sort of out of sight, out of mind, out of an easily digestible mental construct, call it what you will. Now, that is something that I think you ladies and gentlemen need to be concerned about when you, and not just in India, I think in South Asia, because we bring you grand dreams because we have grand dreams. One of the reasons, and I'll tell you how grand those dreams are. I was looking at the stats of Indo-Canadian FDI, foreign direct investment. You guys invested last year 644 million Canadian in India. We invested 3.5 billion or something like 2.7 billion.
10 times, 5 billion.
No, 5.7 times, I checked. I did the math. 5.7 times FDI into... I don't want to diss you because... Sir, I read your stats. You're the consulate. I read the Embassy of India stats out of Ottawa. Sue me. Anyway, point made. The thing is, there is a great amount of emission. Imagine, I mean, we guys are coming here. In 2007 or 8, an Indian company paid $6 billion to buy out Novelis, or Novelis, however you want to pronounce it. I mean, these are things that are happening, and these are things that are happening organically. But I think what people need to pressure India to do better is to govern to our political leadership and our administrative leadership, is to do a better job at running our country. Because I fear that if we do not, and if just... I think what I'll do now is that before I really get into the doomsday stuff, and I have a max scenario that I did for a think tank back home 3 years ago when I looked at I maxed out two scenarios. I'd love to talk to you about them. One was about the internal security situation based around what I call the null zones of administration and governance, or inland and outland, if you will. And also a sort of a situation developing out of impulses in Bangladesh and northeastern India and Myanmar. And if China were to sort of step in a little way, you'd get absolute chaos. If you had sort of flooding in Bangladesh, you had global warming, where would they go? They'd go to India. It's not a very fashionable thing for liberals to hear back home. But hey, I think that's the truth. We'll talk about those things later. But I just want to leave you with this thought that as aspirational and as ambitious and as progressive that we have been over these decades, I think there's a long way to go. And we need to get out of what has come to us over the past 10 years or so. I think, ladies and gentlemen, what happened in the past is that we had so much of an overload of bad news, an association of India and South Asia with bad news. We were the bad news guys, the bad news environment. And since 1991, I think the news has slowly turned to the positive. We have turned a lot more positive than we used to be. The news has also turned in our favor. But I think this good news environment, which we have grasped so sort of manically, if you will, in such a sort of a desperate fashion, if you will, to the extent that an ambitious yuppie Indian or Indian yuppie doesn't want to consider anymore the bad news that goes on in India. We are now, I think, living in what I like to call mall stupor. And thank you, America. I don't blame you guys for that. I have to blame America for that. You're off the hook, by the way. So we live in mall stupor, tens of millions of us. This is not a happy thing. So I think we need to cart the rest of the country with us. I'm using a very arrogant phrase here. Cart the country along with the horse. And we need you and gentlemen, I think, this is my personal pitch to you, I say this wherever I go, that those of you in positions of power and influence in media and government and public life and business, security affairs, whatever it is, media, pressure countries like me, like ours, and regions like ours, who are very ambitious and I think will do good things for people in North America and elsewhere in the world, because we believe in we believe in the improbability of success. None of us should really exist, yet we do. India, the United States of India, is an absolutely lunatic experiment. There's no logic for it to survive, yet we have. That's a grand thing. And I think all of us are beholden. It's up to us to ensure that these things prosper. We help each other, and you help us, to create a region of relatively more stability than it is at present. So you must be pressure groups that, you know, to pressure, not dictatorships, good governance. And I think once you do that, we'd be a far better place than we are now. We would be a far more stable place than we are now. And I think we will be a far more prosperous place than we are now. And then we can take over your country. And why don't I leave it at that, and then I leave my good friend Jas to take ahead the evening.
Thank you, Sudeep. A wonderful analysis, and give us a great idea, a good idea of what's happening throughout the region. There's so many topics I guess I could jump into just based on what you've been talking about here. I just want to focus a little bit on Pakistan a little bit. Mm-hmm. And we can talk about the internal issues in India, and there's many of them. I recall when I was bureau chief there interviewing the former head of Pakistan's spy agency, mm-hmm. Muhammad Gul. And when I was talking to him, he would talk about India as if it was still 1947. He was still fighting partition, had no trust of India. And when I went back to Delhi, I'd interviewed a gentleman named Vikram Sood, the head of mm-hmm. RAW, the Research and Analysis Wing, which is the foreign spy agency for India.
They don't say so, by the way.
And when I asked him, I said, how do you end this debate with Pakistan, this endless conversation with Pakistan? And he goes, it's going to take, 10 years? And he goes, if you asked me that question 20 years ago, I'd have given you some sort of military answer with troops and everything else. But he goes, in answering your question today, he goes, healthcare, education, and infrastructure, and Pakistan is irrelevant to us in 10 years. So that was quite interesting, two different men and two different perspectives. So I ask you this question now. How do you fix this, and can we fix it within our lifetime in regards to the amount of money spent on the Indian side in regards to line of control and Pakistan as well? And Mr. Sood also said to me, he said, it's not up to us. It's not up to the Indian government. Mm-hmm. In fact, it's not even up to the Pakistani government. It's up to the Pakistani military before this thing is solved. That was his perspective. Your thoughts on how this debate that has gone on for decades, decade upon decade, how does that end? Because billions of dollars that have been wasted that can be spent on infrastructure, healthcare, education in both countries. How do you fix this?
And let's not forget the lives lost. If the dead could speak, they would say, let's have peace. So I'm looking for a headline that says, peace breaks out. I mean, that's my killer headline. And I live for that. And but to address your point, I think you're right. I mean, it's a military-led thing. A lot of people in India have sort of switched off from, I believe this sincerely, because I see it every day when I talk to people, deal with people, as I live my life. My life, as I live it, has nothing to do with Pakistan. It has absolutely nothing to do with Pakistan, unless, of course, I'm in a situation like in Bombay, in the Taj Mahal Hotel, and people who have arrived from Pakistan under training and guidance from possibly their intelligence agencies and otherwise. And I'm not being a typical Indian here, and I'll tell you why in a few minutes, a few short minutes. There's no, I don't have a connect unless I'm in that hotel, as I was saying, and I'm attacked and I die, or somebody I know dies or is hurt. There is no immediacy. What's happening in Pakistan, unless you're in the army, you're in the intelligence, you're in the diplomatic services, you're in the ministries or public policy situations which deals with Pakistan, and or you're a resident of what we call Jammu and Kashmir, which as this map would be banned back home, by the way. Let me explain. In Indian maps, this is part of India, okay? And that too is part of India. All right. And we've never really forgiven Pakistan for ceding that to China. We still believe this is our land and so on and so forth. Anyway, so I don't think that... and now Pakistan appears to be on its own dynamic. And the Consul General is here. I mean, he's the face of India in Vancouver. And I think he'd be a better person to brief you on these aspects of official Indian policy vis-a-vis the rest of the world. Though, cash him off the record. He's not going to say a darn thing on the record. I can tell you that. I don't think that we can really do very much in Pakistan unless Pakistan takes charge of its own destiny. And that's a disturbing thing, because it doesn't, except for a few people, in relative terms, it doesn't seem like Pakistan is really moving in the same direction. Balochistan, which is a province of Pakistan, appears to be traveling in its own trajectory. Karachi, which thinks of itself as a country, as a nation on its own, and those of you who visit Karachi and know the dynamic of Karachi will understand why. The Punjab in Pakistan thinks it runs the country, and maybe it does. The tribal regions in the north of Pakistan are a law and a force unto themselves, and they really don't give a damn as to what the world thinks, or even what Pakistan thinks of it. And it's proven over and over again. And you have the impulse from Afghanistan, which, as we are here this evening, is, I think, again, back to the brink. And how many times is it going to go back to the brink? So, and Pakistan and Afghanistan, that part of Pakistan, at any rate, the northwest part that abuts Afghanistan, is really falling apart. And I don't know what India can do, even by developing ourselves, except to sort of maybe keep our hands off. And sometimes it gets difficult to do. I'll give you a reason why. There's this, when Indians talk about Pakistan using terror as an extension of state policy, of foreign policy, people turn to India and say that, you know, you guys are completely paranoid, and you guys do to us in Balochistan what we might do to you in Kashmir, and anyway, that's a freedom struggle, and so on and so forth. The assassinated former Prime Minister of Pakistan, Benazir Bhutto, apart from the India Today conclave, after that I migrated to a media house called the Hindustan Times Group, and I sort of templated another conclave for them, which we call the Hindustan Times Leadership Initiative. Benazir Bhutto visited us in 2003, November, and it's the first time on the record that any senior leader of Pakistan, not from the military, went on the record during a question and answer session and she said that she was premier then, in 1989. She said that, yes, I was prime minister, as a reply to a direct question. And it was during my premiership that we directed the ISI, the Inter-Services Intelligence, to take its mandate outside Kashmir, so to take it beyond Kashmir and into greater India, if you will. And this is on the record. Those of you who don't believe me, I'll email you the transcript. So, you know, and there's a video of it as well online, so you can see it for yourselves. So I don't know whether that dynamic has abated in Pakistan. I suspect not, because the more paranoid a situation gets, the more repressive and the most insular it gets. So I don't know, Jas. I think we need to do what we need to do in India, and where Pakistan intersects with the way we like to live our lives or like to live our foreign policy, I think it will. I think that's the way a vast majority of Indians look at Pakistan, except for when we are playing cricket with each other. Then everybody's interested in Pakistan directly. When there is this corruption in betting, illegal betting in cricket, everyone's interested. And when Pakistan occasionally decides that, and India too on occasion, by the way, we decide that we want that extra square mile of land in this totally inhospitable glacier up north in the Karakoram area, that we want a little square mile more, a square mile less. We send in the army. We say that these are freedom fighters. There's a war that erupts, sometimes short, sometimes very, very long as well. Kills many, many people. The patriotism, the patriotic fervor is ratcheted up in both countries. And then suddenly Pakistan comes alive. Or when there is a bombing or an explosion or a terrorist act like in Bombay, then Pakistan comes alive. But other than that, I don't know, Jas. I mean, I don't know if anybody can solve that except Pakistan itself. And I think the UN is even impotent. America has been proven to be impotent in that area for decades now. Russia has been proven to be impotent in that area. So, I mean, we're just India, you know. We're not even a superpower yet.
One of the We've seen many protests around the world, from Egypt, in India, in regards to concerns over corruption, even in Brazil as well. Mm-hmm. Today, Transparency International put out a global corruption barometer where they interviewed 114,000 people, and the majority of people say that corruption has actually worsened worldwide in the past 2 years, and the political parties, they believe, are the most corrupt institutions. They looked at various parameters. And even in Canada here, we have a conversation going on right now in regards to our Senate, certain senators who were charging for expenses, probably small in the great in the grand scheme of things, but we certainly have issues here in Canada as well. In India, we had this tremendous amount of opposition, or at least protest last year, where people talked about the middle class being fed up with corruption. And that at its core, there's prosperity in India, but the middle class doesn't have any power. That political parties at their core in India are really there to represent the rich or the rural poor. So in regards to Indian politics, and you've got an election coming, I believe, next year.
Yes.
And it's a very wide-ranging question, but how do you fix that? Because you're talking about government and government and governance earlier when you were chatting. How do you fix it?
Well, but did you say that the middle class was upset with?
Just in regards to, and it's not just in India, but you've seen a lot of BRIC nations, that there's prosperity there,
sure.
But they're not necessarily have power. The middle class specifically.
You know, forgive me. I was a bit wicked. I wanted you to say it again. Just to stress what I'm about to say, I think the middle class in India is thoroughly spoiled. We are spoiled brats. I don't think the middle class has any right to be upset about any darn thing. And I wish I could be ruder, but you know, I'm in civilized company. We have had it good. We've worked very hard for it. Of course, we all do. And those of us, and you know that those of us who are in your country have done well for themselves by working brutally hard as well. So we can work hard, and we do, even back home. It's a myth that we don't work back home. So the middle class has used its opportunities and created a space for themselves, for itself. And I think what the middle class has realized, what rural India had realized, had always known, is that the political establishment, even in pre-independence India and subsequently, the governance aspect, I think they've been less insulated than the middle class of India or urban India for the long time. So I think the middle class has woken up to a reality that rural India or non-middle class India has always known. So that's why I said I think the middle class of India is quite spoiled. We are corrupt. We must do something about corruption. But again, having said that, it's a grand thing that they've finally woken up to that fact. And I believe that they've begun to vote with their feet. People are coming out on the streets, like Arab Spring and elsewhere. Though I have my differences about what exactly is going on in Egypt right now. I mean, you take to the street to throw out a democratically elected government, I'm not sure. But that's another story for another time and another place. But I sneak that in anyway. In my country, a lot of people in the cities, cutting across socioeconomic castes, if I may call it that, because in that we're still quite British. We do have a economic caste system as well, along with the socio aspect of the caste system. People have taken to the streets, and they're trying to vote with their feet by demanding accountability in various ways, and I think that's a grand, grand thing. It's a wonderful thing. So here I'll defend my tribe. I think it'll make a great difference because this is also a very talkative tribe. We hog all the talk time on television. We hog vast amounts of public perceptions, and we are also vast city-states of our own. Bombay is 14 million people. Calcutta is more than about between 10 and 11 million people. Chennai, Bangalore, these are all 5 million plus cities. We are city-states of our own, and we now have momentum. We have a voice that I think the Indian legislative system, the parliamentarians, our legislators, our MPs, and people in the legislative assembly in our provinces can no longer ignore. In the past, they could ignore the middle class by saying they're of absolutely no consequence when it comes to voting in elections, because your vote is like between 4% and 5% of the electorate. I mean, the vast majority is out there in the rural areas. That's where we get the bang for the buck. You guys are just sort of nothing, the irrelevant. I think that's begun to change. There's a lot more bite in the bark of the middle class, and we're seeing that happening. And I believe that this is one of the reasons why people are often paranoid about the Maoist rebellion. And in my heart, I understand and appreciate why they're taking up arms. I'm digressing with a reason, just stay with me, for a 9-to-1 chance of being dead very shortly after picking up the weapons against the Indian state. The Indian state is an extremely powerful entity. So why would you take up weapons, et cetera, et cetera, knowing that you will die quite soon or quite possibly. You lead short lives thereafter. I think, and there's a bogey that the Maoist rebellion will proliferate and take over India, and we'll have, like in Peking, what Mao did in 1949, will encircle the countryside, encircle the citadel, i.e. Peking, Beijing, and in India's case, New Delhi. I don't think it's about to happen because of the various things that are happening in my country. One of the things, which is sort of very urban-oriented, but now spreading in the countryside as well, is something that we call the Right to Information Act. I think as Indians, we should be very proud of that because it brings more accountability. It demands more accountability of government and how government uses funds and how government departments uses budgetary support and so on and so forth. I think these methods, these measures that are happening, which reinforce, which bolster our constitutional deliverables, if you will, I think are good things, and the middle class is taking after many, many years, the middle class is taking a leading role in it. I think that's a good thing.
In regards to the election next year, then, you have the BJP, where there's been many are expecting a change in leadership, obviously, with Mr. Advani moving on.
No, excuse me. Are you saying that the BJP will come to power? Are you saying
I'm not saying that. I'm just saying in regards to the leadership of the party. Within the party. Okay. With the Congress party.
You know what he's setting up, right? I mean, you guys.
No, I'm curious in regards to, you're talking about the middle class. Mm-hmm. I'm curious in regards to the election next year. Mm-hmm. Mr. Modi is viewed as a star. What's a legitimate question, I believe. And then on the other side, you have Rahul Gandhi potentially running Congress.
Oh, really?
Potentially. Mm. Potentially. Oh, okay. We have the same issues here with the Trudeau family. Americans have the Kennedys. Of course, India has the Gandhis. Give me a sense of what's happening on the federal level in regards to the political situation and what you see with the election coming.
Okay, can I try and go to jail quickly? I shall not collect 200 and not pass go. A little aside on the Gandhis, they have nothing to do with Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, by the way. Those of you who don't know should know this. And I love saying this. They're part of what we call the NGs, the Nehru Gandhis. Mrs. Gandhi married a gentleman called Gandhi. She was Nehru and adopted the gentleman's name and changed the spelling of the name to suit Mohandas Gandhi, the gentleman we call the Mahatma, the great soul. They have nothing to do with that aspect of the Gandhis. They don't take out full-page advertisements in the newspapers to declare that difference. It's done them, I think, a world of good. But Rahul Gandhi, okay, if you say so.
Yeah.
I think what's happening is that we are not... I think the political parties, this is my personal opinion, of course, is that they haven't yet realized the depth of public anger against the political system. I don't think the parties have quite realized it, and I would put the BJP, the Bharatiya Janata Party, which is now in the opposition, and many people expect the BJP to come to power when we have general elections next year. And the Congress Party will then go into remission. That is the talk. I believe that both these parties, if they so think, they must also so think because they must win or try to win. But I believe sincerely that we can't write off what is in my country being called the third front, sort of the alternate, if you will, conglomerate to the Congress conglomerate or the Congress alliance and the BJP conglomerate or the BJP alliance. You might get a few surprises thrown in, and I wouldn't be surprised at all if you get a very tangential prime minister, if you will. Come next May or June when elections are on their way and we'll have a new government. I don't know what kind of government it'll be. But it's yet too soon to crown those of among you here, kidding, would like to crown Mr. Modi Prime Minister. Might have to wait a while. You can't project him as Prime Minister yet. I think those of among you who like the Gandhis, who are not the Gandhis, to expect Rahul Gandhi to become the next Prime Minister of India as well. It's way too early, and it's a good thing, I believe, that even though it might suggest fracture, political fracture in India, though it might suggest a sort of an unmanageable diversity of political thought, if you will, it's a wonderful thing that there is indeed the option of a third front. I'm appalled that in a country as diverse as India, these two parties have led the way for decades and sometimes led India to ruin as well. So I'm not voting for the third front necessarily, but we can't conclude yet. I think it's way too soon to say which combination will come to power next year. I think we need to wait and watch.
We live next to a very noisy neighbor, the United States, and the politics there has been quite polarized, particularly during the Obama administration, Republicans and Democrats, and people have said that it's gotten to the point where the U.S. is almost ungovernable. Nobody's flexible, no one's trying to do the right thing in the long term. In India's case, there's so much diversity.
Are you visiting the States anytime soon? I mean, are you sure you don't?
I probably will be, yeah, okay. Yeah. I still go. But okay. In regards to the politics, there just seems to be no flexibility, right? In India, when you have 1.2 billion people, you need to, obviously, most governments obviously are coalition. Mm-hmm. Critics in the West will say it's just ungovernable over the long term, getting things done, particularly when you compare it to China, and what China's been able to accomplish in 30 to 40 years. What do you say to those Western critics?
I think they're both right and wrong. You can't argue with what China has emerged. And in fact, I was telling, I was at dinner yesterday, and I think I was saying that the one place that I've seen a German banker feel insecure is Shanghai. The European bankers, I think, are even more arrogant than North American bankers. If there is a place that the European banker feels diminished, then it's Shanghai, China. They just sort of bludgeoned into submission. They're just awestruck. Short point, you can't deny that China's emerged as what it is. And the hotel I stay at, the Pan Pacific, when I look north, northwest, I see these 7 or 8 condominiums, which are very swish and completely dark darkened after sunset. I'm told that a vast amount of that investment has come from Shanghai or Peking or mainland China, at any rate. There goes my visa and to China. You can't argue with these things. And a lot of people, of course, the cliche is that because China has been totalitarian and emphatic in the way it has pushed its policy to the extent that Mao today is seen as... But they're very clever. They won't write Mao off, of course. He's on the money, as we all know. He's still on the currency. But even Deng Xiaoping would say, and after that, they would say, like, Mao is 30% bad, 70% bad, 30% good. So, yes, there is an emphatic move, has been for many years, to force China to move in a particular way. In India, it's been a lot more chaotic, for sure. But I think we are still moving. We haven't stalled. China is growing at, 11% this year, and they're absolutely worried, between 10 and 11%. We are growing between 5.5% to 6.2 or 3% through this year, and we're worried about it. But that just tells you how far ahead China is, and they have a bigger base to begin with. But with all this policy chaos and with the churn of India, I think if you look at surveys repeatedly conducted over the last 15 years in particular, people would, in many ways, look at India as a sort of a medium to long-term bent, and possibly a more legally secure bent as well when it comes to putting money on the ground, even with all the negative energies that we have in India and South Asia. Despite all of that, or in spite of all that, it is still seen as a relatively more amenable place legally and in terms of human rights situation and so on and so forth compared to China. And what can I say? Good for China. China is vast and powerful and grand and absolutely wants to take over the world. And they have, as Jas knows very well, they have this string of pearl business going on. A very elegant way of saying that we're going to throttle you into submission. We know, of course, the Spratlys, Malaysia has been, Philippines, Malaysia, Vietnam, they've been all claiming the hell out of it, but China just says it's ours and deal with it. string of pearls right down here, and the string of pearls extends now here. And this is our string of pearls, or our golden necklace that we want to impose on the Indian Ocean area as well.
But China, correct me if I'm wrong, are they not building a port or have finished building a port in Sri Lanka?
They have a port. They've funded the building of a port right here called Hambantota. It's a deepwater port. And the U.S. is scared sleepless, I would have used another word, that it will stage, China will stage its navy or naval complements out of Hambantota. China already has over here a port called Gwadar. There is absolutely no logic for that port to exist, except to lease it out to the People's Republic of China. So these are impulses that you can't deny, that China is sort of making a very forceful play in Southeast Asia and this whole Bay of Bengal, Arabian Sea, Indian Ocean area. And as you know very well, they've sort of leapfrogged into Africa ages ago, and we're just in India, just following. We're just crawling behind them, you know, in a way. And they have us in control in Nepal. They have us in control vis-a-vis Pakistan, very much so. Premier Li Keqiang, I've been trying to pronounce it for a long time. Have I got it correct? Visited India, and before that, this is just less than 2 months ago, and said that this was called the handshake across the Himalayas, as he called it. So he came and shook hands with India, and then promptly went to Pakistan, of course, and said, you are our friends forever, so on and so forth. Yeah. So all of that happened. So they are going beyond business. This is a very clever country. I mean, it is a supremely clever country. I was listening to an investment banker talk about China, and they said that, look, you know, we think in terms of quarters. We think in terms of like the 3-monthly ROI, you know, what we're giving our investors, weekly even. We think in terms of returns on investment for a year, 5 years, 10. These guys think in terms of 100 years, 50 years. He said that on a good day, probably a policymaker in China, however corrupt or totalitarian he may be, is thinking of the grand empire of China 500 years hence. I mean, I've heard bankers, when they're sober, tell me this. So what can you do? I mean, at best, we can... I don't think India needs to play catch-up, if that's a sort of a leading question, if you will. But you can't really do much with China except to sort of try not to play along as much as you can afford to, or as much as you can be brave about not playing along with what China is trying to do. And so good luck to all of us.
And the trade has improved with India and China. I mean, I think they've gone from $2 billion to $80 billion in regards to trade in the last decade or so. So they are, while they may be arguing, they are still trading.
Well, that's the beauty of China. We talk conflict at one point and we talk business at the other. When the Premier of China visited India, they talked a lot about business. Last week, the Defense Minister of China of India had visited China, and the chairman, the head of the PLA, the People's Liberation Army, which I think actually runs China, they put out a statement saying that we don't like what India is doing by increasing its presence of patrols along the line of actual control here and over here. So we don't like it. I mean, what the hell? It's okay. The phones in India are made in China, as I'm sure over here. The computer I use is a Lenovo computer, which used to be an IBM computer, and now Lenovo is a Chinese company. It's a made in China machine. Everything in India that we use, we have a festival called Holi, which is the festival of color. A lot of the colors now come from China. A lot of the firecrackers come from China, which is a bit obvious, but even the holy colors come from China. A lot of the buckets that people use in the rural areas, the plastic, that comes from China. We ship chips, chemical chips, to the eastern seaboard of China, and they ship us back what we ship them as raw material. We ship them iron ore from the Maoist areas and in southern India and eastern India, and the shippers back finished metal products. It's as bizarre a relationship as the world is bizarre.
I recall when I was in Delhi, I picked up a little statue of Ganesh and I looked at the bottom. It said, made in China.
So, there you go.
There you go. So. A couple more questions and then I'm going to throw it to you folks. I wanted to touch a little bit on the Naxalites. You've been talking about this. What... Why did you want to write about them? Why about that movement? I know there's been a lot of talk in the electronic media in India, mm-hmm. but to go there, live there, analyze it, write a book, and another book as well, give me a sense of why you wanted to do this.
Okay. I mean, I've been a more or less a lifelong journalist, and one of the things that I found constraining when I was a career journalist, a tenure journalist, if you will, was that we couldn't always say the things that we wanted to do, and my organizations, I have no hesitation in saying this, they're very well regarded, respected, and yet they, I think, were equally caught up in what I call mall stupor. They just didn't want to hear the other side of the story. We were just so caught up in sort of drumming up belief in ourselves to plump up our own resumes as the way we saw our resumes as urban global India that we forgot to, we'd neglected to look at the other aspects of India. And when I decided to leave full-time media as in 2004, finally, and moved to Goa, the Lotus Eaters Paradise, I thought I'd research and write about issues that I could not fully address while in media as a reporter, editor, writer, even as a mentor for many of my junior colleagues who I'd pushed, but there was always a wall that stopped you because we just didn't want to believe. I remember my publisher telling me, and I'll never get a job again after this, back at India Today Group, I guess, is that we said that why don't you write more about the northeastern part? Why don't you write more about the central Indian part where there's a lot of conflict? I mean, who wants to know? I mean, who wants to read about it? They don't. I mean, we don't sell our magazine there. I mean, who cares? That was basically what we got. So when I left, I thought that the least I could do was then address this mall stupor, and I sincerely and firmly believe that that my chosen path now for these past nearly 10 years is to write about issues of conflict and not just issues of conflict with the Maoist rebellion, like the Maoist rebellion or the Northeast. The book I'm working on right now is actually an issue where business and human rights go head to head. I believe you have a similar situation coming up shortly in Alberta with the First Nation people, something called the Ring of Fire in Canada, Ontario, sorry. Where there's a lot of mining interests and there's sort of between $30 and $50 billion worth of minerals over there. And there is an issue with the First Nation people. It's a digression. I don't mean to, as if to use an Americanism, diss you people. But I'm just saying that these are the issues that crop up even with well-meaning business ventures or economic development ventures. And I'm looking at issues of conflict over there in India right now. So my thing is that, I mean, those of us who deal with conflict resolution, there is a sort of a formula that works. Sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. And Shrinks will tell you that very well. Is it to deal with a problem, you must acknowledge that there is indeed a problem. And then you're exposed to that problem, you learn about that problem. When you acknowledge that, then you begin to be aware of that problem. And then you begin to walk towards a solution. The same in our lives, the same with conflict situations. And my work, I'm dying to show you my books, but I'll refrain from it. I'm a good boy.
What I find amazing is just that if this happened in China,
wouldn't take place.
In U.S. or wherever it may be, but for it to go on for decades, literally, right? Mm-hmm. That's what I find amazing, that it's not just the media, but the middle class, the government, everybody's in a mall stupor.
It's a deliberate blindsiding. I think, since I really believe that it has been done to make ourselves look better in many, many ways, in our own eyes, in our own estimation, in our own ambitions. We, as I said earlier, a little earlier, we want to make our resume look even better than it perhaps is as a nation. So there is this grand blindsiding, and I want to break through that. I want to take people by the scruff of their necks, and I'm writing for people like us, if you will. I'm not writing for the rebel. I don't need to tell them why they're rebelling. They know very well. I want to bring the stories to the living rooms of India, the salons of India, and say, look, guys, this is, ladies and gentlemen, this is what's going on. This is what we must recognize in order for us to at least attempt to walk towards a future, if not of peace and prosperity, then at least absence of conflict. We must try and walk towards that future together, or at least try to even acknowledge that we have a future together. So that's what drives my work, and that's what drove me to write the book on Naxalites and the Maoist movement, and also a conflict situation in northeastern India. And the grand thing, Jas and ladies and gentlemen, is, and that's one of the things that makes me very proud as an Indian, is that this evening may not have taken place in Pakistan. Let's be realistic about it. There would have been people trying to shut us down. This evening would definitely not have happened in China. This evening may happen in Myanmar. I'm not sure yet. It's a bit of touch and go. Definitely would not happen in Sri Lanka. I'd be in jail. That's a good thing, by the way. I'll get that fellowship at Brown University in America. They want you to be jailed and tortured and beaten before they give you a fellowship. So all the Congolese and the Cote d'Ivoireans are getting the fellowship and not me. You know? So this is my grand attempt to get jailed. So there is debate, and I can't resist this, because none of these books, which are very dark and broody and fairly violent books, this book is not banned back home. It is freely available. That's a wonderful thing. That means we have matured as a democratic space over the years. This book is not banned. This book is, however, banned in a couple of states of India, where I'm on the list for being arrested, and they also formally wrote to Google to break my password and give it to them. Someone called me first and said, change the password. That's another story. This book, which is set in Northeast India, called Highway 39, the blurb at the back, and I want you to just absorb the enormity, if you will, of this blurb in the context of my region. There's a Naga gentleman who told me this. He said, do you want an honest answer? I don't consider myself to be an Indian. That is at the back of my book. It's freely available in India. It is not banned, and I'm so very proud. I mean, I won't get that fellowship, but I'm so proud. So wonderful things have happened to my country, as much as all the grotesquely atrocious things that have happened as well. And that's, I think, what makes me do what I do, is that try and turn a bit more, some of that negative energy into a positive energy. And if it means Jas and I pick up these pretty umbrellas and twirl them around to entertain you, we'll do that as well. I promise you.
One more question, I'm going to hand it to you folks. And that's about the environment. I've had the incredible opportunity to breathe New Delhi and Beijing air.
And he lives.
And I live.
And he lives.
And here in British Columbia, we have locally a debate going on about coal shipments to Asia. Metallurgical coal, which we ship to make steel, and in return we get iPads and cars, and the U.S. sends thermal coal through here for heating and all those other things. Yes. In Asia. Sam Petrodo was here for the Asia-Pacific Foundation's get-together conference, I think a few weeks ago, and I got a chance to talk to him. And I brought up the issue of coal and Western environmentalists talking about the global warming. Legitimate issues I think most people would agree with. But Mr. Petrodo said, we understand and would agree, but you can only complain to a certain point. We still have to build our economies. And yes, they have burned coal, but by doing so, the rise of India and China has taken tens and millions of people out of poverty. Don't be lecturing us. Yet, you've spent a bad day in Beijing. Mr. Khan, as you know and I know, it's bad. It is really bad. And even in India, things got a little bit better. I think they brought in CNG stations and rickshaws and taxis that run on compressed natural gas, even buses, in some ways leapfrogging the so-called developed world. Yet now, the love affair of the car, things seem to be getting worse. Somebody told me the average speed during Delhi rush hour was 30 kilometers per hour. It's now dipped down to 18 just because so many cars are on the road. I've gone down the Varanasi, talked to farmers. We talked about water diversion in China.
You did not take a bath in the Ganges, I hope.
I did not.
Okay,
no,
good.
No.
Good. That's
no.
a good thing. Sorry.
But I want to talk to you about this because it's a real issue. We can talk about theory here in British Columbia and in Canada, but it's real there. The Gangotri Glacier and the ice melt there in regards to the impact on the...
Did we miss a flood in Toronto?
Calgary.
Just checking.
Yeah. Calgary. Calgary.
Yeah, Calgary.
Yeah. But
Toronto as well, right? It was flooded, and I saw this picture of this Ferrari that was abandoned, and the guy says, oh, it's okay, I needed a new car or something.
Yeah. So. But the issues are real in regards to flooding. You talked about the issue of Bangladesh, and if there's flooding, people having to move into India. Mm-hmm. These issues are real. Give me a sense of of what we're seeing in South Asia and the issues that have to be dealt with, particularly this, because I don't think it's been discussed enough.
No, I don't think it has, and that scares me sleepless.
Let me fix you, Mike,
want to use that word.
Sudeep, let me do this mic one last time before it falls. Okay, sorry. It's going to fall.
That's the difference between a TV guy and a print guy. We don't know how to handle our mics.
There we go.
Thanks, Jas.
Yep.
So I think we're okay. The battery is recovered. I haven't been pressing it quite so much. We are suffering from a grand deforestation on a grand scale, and we do not have Sting to sing songs on our behalf and save the Amazon. And we don't have Bono and other people fighting on our behalf and bringing our stories to you. So we're in pretty bad shape, and that's scary. We recently had a landslide because of flash floods and because of overabundant rain, if you will, in this area. It's a province called Uttarakhand, in a sort of a holy area where there are many pilgrimage sites. And during a deluge and downpour, there's no trees there. I mean, it's a place that I visited as a child for trekking, not for pilgrimage. Clear? And I did see trees, and there are just no trees there anymore. And when the downpour came, it just sort of washed down the mountain side, and the momentum took the entire towns and villages with it, and disrupted areas 100 kilometers downstream. This is the route of the Ganga, or the tributaries of the Ganga that is doing this. You have a situation there. There is a combination of water, which we don't know what to do with, and also lack of water, which we don't know what to do with, and I think that's happening on account of global warming. I'm not a scientist. I'm only going by what I hear and read on that count. But I can see over my relatively short lifetime that things have got much worse, and that scares me in many, many ways. There's a glacial issue up in northern... I'm out of battery. Where the tip says 1972 line of control, sort of a little south of that, there's a river called the Indus, which actually gives a name to my country. The Hindu comes from Indus, by the way. That's my school of thought. That river runs across the border into Pakistan and ends up near Karachi, decants into the Arabian Sea around there. And Pakistan is fighting with India right now. That's one of our sort of unresolved conflicts. Thankfully not violent, that says that you're not giving us enough water, and India says that, well, we're giving you all the water we can, but we need water for ourselves. And it's lessening because the glacial melt has reduced over there. We're getting into a crisis situation. A little to the east of that, we have out-of-control water, which I just described to you. Then the Ganga and many of its tributaries, it becomes a very powerful river because many tributaries descend from Nepal into the Gangetic Plains around here. A series of major rivers, if you want to call them major, minor, 6 to 10 of them, they come into this area. They create havoc whenever there is abundant rain because there's no control. There is deforestation. There is nothing to keep the water back. In the natural sense. And this is a bad rain year, and usually when it rains that bad, this entire area gets flooded. The northeast being deforested. China is trying to grab what we call the Brahmaputra River, which runs across this part and goes into Dhaka, Bangladesh, and comes over here. You have these mixed signals of drought, too much rain, too much water, too little water, you don't know what to do with. And then you have the Bangladesh situation where, I mean, every time there's a cyclone or a storm, millions of people, not just tens of thousands of people, move up from this highly populated area, and they move up, and they move here, and they move there. Imagine what can happen if there is a global warming situation and waters even rise an inch or two. It will flood the U.S. base over here. Not a bad thing, always.
They're at sea level, I think.
Sorry?
The Maldives are at just like 1 or 2 feet above
sea level. It's like here. I mean, there.
Yeah. I think the parliament there actually...
By the way, the Maldives is about, 1.7 times the size of D.C., right? So it's a tiny place land-wise, so it can get swamped. And imagine what can that can do to Bangladesh, where a maximum number of people live in this region, the deltaic region. And where do they go? They go north. And how much can Bangladesh take? I mean, we've grown in terms of population. Bangladesh, in the last 10 to 15 years, has grown from 100 million to, I was checking the stats today, to about 160 odd. And just exploding, where do they go? We're looking at catastrophe. If there is a change of level in how the storm systems work, how the water levels go, and that can absolutely fracture the northeast part of India, I think, if were that to happen. It can do disastrous thing to the eastern part of India, this region which surrounds Bangladesh. I mean, there's no way for the Bangladeshi to go anywhere except out, further up into its own territory, into Bangladesh's own territory, and then this region. So you're looking at a potential catastrophe.
Environmental refugees.
Yeah, really. I mean, were that to happen. So, I mean, that was one of my, like, ultra-max scenarios that I played out for this think tank. And that's really what I think can happen. I mean, it's frightening, ladies and gentlemen. It's really, really frightening.
In regards to the water issue with Pakistan or even with China, the dams you're talking
yes.
about, those you could have geopolitical ramifications. You could actually, I mean, maybe worst case scenario, but there could be a war, particularly with Pakistan,
yes.
if their farmers aren't getting the water. I mean, that's how real it is.
Sure, because we are very well irrigated in this part. The Punjab, though even the Punjab has some water issues right now. Yeah, so there, in fact, it is already a point of conflict, the Indus water sharing between India and Pakistan. I mean, there is a situation here where there is a territorial in Sir Creek and issues, but the Indus water treaty between India and Pakistan is a sort of a bilateral issue for sure. And China is damming, has plans to dam the source of the Brahmaputra with sort of, it's called Tsangpo there in Tibet, sorry, China. And it comes in here and traverses this aspect and goes into Bangladesh there. And so China is building between 4 to 6 dams, at least on the record. And that has become a pretty big issue between, or a developing issue between India and China, saying that, you know, you guys are going to kill our river. And the Bangladeshis haven't woken up to it as yet. They're fighting with India for a river called the Tista, which comes down here and goes into Bangladesh here. And we've dammed the Tista twice, and we're building a couple of power plants, hydro stations on that particular river. I was there with my daughter last May, and I know that story. So Bangladesh is upset because we're not letting enough water in, and they're saying that our farmers are starving, they're not getting starved of water, so on and so forth. And they haven't yet woken up to the Brahmaputra issue, because if China were to go into damming that, it will not just be an India-China issue, it'll be a trilateral issue, ultimately, I think. The Consul General was better schooled to discuss these matters, but thank you for your indulgence and patience. And that's where we're headed. There are rivers here, river systems here, which we're trying to dam. There's a dam in the trijunction of the state called Manipur, Tripura, and Mizoram, called Tipaimukh. As we speak, there is a protest going on because the government wants to divert 22,000 odd hectares of land, of forested land, for that dam. And what it will do is that it dams a river that drains into Bangladesh. So now that has become is developing into a bilateral issue. And when Indian activists got up and told the government that we don't want that dam, guess who supported the activists? Bangladesh. So it's got quite complicated, and I sense it'll only get worse because we are so many of us. In Canada, I think you can still deal with issues of population where you have so few people, relatively few people. In South Asia, we're I mean, come on, don't start me off on the population. I mean, we're just too many of us, and that is really the problem with so many things, including climate change and results thereof or therefrom.
I want to get some of you folks involved here. Anybody have any questions in regards to politics, economics, environment? Yes, sir.
I'm curious how several journalists have
used the mic to get recorded.
Oh, excellent. Oh, well, they're recording this for future broadcasts, so
So this is our 15 seconds of fame, yours and mine both. So go for it.
I'm curious how several journalists have turned from their journalistic writings to have resorted to the form of the novel. And I'm curious, would you care to say something about that? There's White Tiger and Arvind Adiga, there's Your Red Sun and yourself.
And there's Jeet Pyle. Let's not forget my good friend Jeet here used to be a journalist. He used to be with Asia Week, by the way, out of Southeast Asia for many, many years. And Jeet's now a fabulous writer, and he's always been a fabulous writer. I envy you, Jeet, by the way. He's a poet and a writer of great prose as well. So I think all of us are into avatars in some ways, right? Sometimes we are done with one avatar and we want another avatar. It's a time in our lives when we sort of transition from one, something that we do, to something else that we want to do. And writing is what I did for a living, or so I thought. It's a delusion that you must permit me. I mean, after all, that's why I'm here, right? So it didn't seem unnatural, you know, for me to do that. I had a fight.
But why the novel and not nonfiction?
I do both. Finally, I get the chance. Yes! A glass of wine on me outside. Red, white, rosé, anything. Novel, Tin Fish, my first book, written after a fight with my publisher. I came home poured two stiff vodkas, had both very quickly sat down to write a book of fiction. First draft, 6 weeks, done in 6 months. The Germans have spell Angst with a capital A. So I practice that. Novel, sequel to Tin Fish, called The Avenue of Kings. And those of you, and since this is Vancouver, I must say that it opens with 1984, which is not George Orwell in India. It is bad blood, let me put it as mildly as possible. Fiction. Non-fiction. Red Sun travels in Naxalite country. You, of course, need to be a bit schizophrenic to do this, but I am a practicing schizophrenic, as by now you've gathered. This is non-fiction, but it's narrative non-fiction. So it has a prose style, because I've chosen to bring the story out from a sort of an academic approach and try and reach it out to more people. And this, Highway 39, which is set like Red Sun, it is a work of nonfiction. This is set in northeastern India, in the states of Nagaland and Manipur. It's nonfiction. The one I'm working on right now is nonfiction. I go back to fiction. So it is both, because I like both mediums. It's not an unnatural thing, and I just feel liberated to be able to go beyond 600 words for an article or 2,000 words for a magazine cover story. I got, 140,000 words in this. I mean, it feeds my ego, my delusion, my creativity. You know, why should I stop? You know.
Up there, yes, sir. Oh, right there.
For those of us who don't know the detailed stories of India, I want to thank you for the sweep and interest of your talk this evening. We, like you, I think, celebrate the vibrancy of Indian democracy, its openness, its argumentative culture. And it was a pleasure to hear you talk about things which in our own country have a particular political slant these days, that is, root causes, which increasingly are translated as a support for terrorism. And your accounts of the sociological and economic complexities in India, which in our country these days are the lesser sin than supporting terrorism, but the sin of committing sociology. But despite all this, I want you to go back to what you said about electoral politics and the promise of the third way. It sounds as if the established competing coalitions of the Congress and the Hindu nationalists have essentially disregarded the fundamentals and the root causes, and you speak optimistically about a third force. Mm-hmm. How is it organized, and why do you think it it will make an impact in the next election and in the near future?
Okay, just a quick clarification. The loads of the third force, the constituents of a possible third force, are also, by the way, not any less corrupt than constituents of the Congress and the BJP, the current opposition party, and their allies. The Congress leads a coalition called UPA, United Progressive Alliance, and the BJP, it earlier led and continues to lead in opposition, an alliance called NDA, National Democratic Alliance. Neither have sort of groupings have exhibited elements of progressiveness or democracy on several occasions. And the Third Front, I don't know what it could be called. It'll be probably called the Third Democratic Front or whatever. Or the Janata, that means people. We like to project ourselves as governments of the people, government for the people, though we are not necessarily. That third force is really, a political convenience rather than a third force developing out of a great love and affection for the people of India. Our politicians are absolutely cynical. I'm just dying to say bad things. Let it be unsaid, enough said, right? Are, I think, just abusers of power and greatly delusional people. And they have corrupted the systems of India, which they themselves helped create. And the third front, a possible third front, is not free of that guilt or that sin. So what Jas alluded to in his question a little while ago, when he talked about a protest sort of coming of age in urban India, when people have taken to the streets to protest so many ills that we have, particularly the ills against governance. That actually, the core of that movement has spawned a party called the Aam Aadmi Party, the party of the common man or the common people. That, in a way, thus far, is relatively untouched by issues of corruption and misgovernance because they haven't had a chance to be, I think, corrupt and to misgovern. They're not going to do great things for our country's electoral politics because it's a very, very tiny, very, very infinitesimal part of the Indian political process right now, but a very loud one. They get loads of TV time. The third front, therefore, comprises people who are deeply suspect, by the way. There is a lady who was just 3 days ago called Mayawati, who proclaimed her intention to be the future Prime Minister of India publicly. She is accused of great and grand corruption, by the way. And though she comes from a relatively, what we call a low caste, and therefore is a success story of affirmative action in her own way, but she, when you come into the system, you are grandly corrupted by the system because it's such a darn party. There is a lady called Mamata Banerjee who, do we know Alice in Wonderland? I call her Malice in Wonderland. Again, I'm trying to get jailed here. Help me. She purports to govern the state of West Bengal, which I call home, or I used to before I moved to Goa. If you criticize anything she does, she calls you a Maoist, including if she visits somebody who's been raped and goes to offer her sympathies, and they talk to her about lack of law and order. She said, but you're a Maoist. I mean, like off with your head kind of thing. She might be part of the Third Front, and God forbid if she becomes Prime Minister. So the Third Front will have these jokers in the pack, literally. And these are vicious, dangerous jokers that we have, which our democracy allows to flourish, ironically. So one lives in hope, one believes in democracy, and there you have it.
Any other questions? Yes, sir, back there.
Can you talk about the notion of a South Asian economic community model after the European community as an economic and a political possibility of resolving the past and the future?
Okay, there is an entity, not a very robust entity, called SARC, the South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation, which I personally am a great votary of. I actually accompanied the Prime Minister of India as part of his media team for the first SAARC conference in Dhaka many years ago. And I'm a great believer in South Asian, not an identity, if you will, because even in the European Union, it's really a union of currency and ease of travel and labor, movement of labor, rather than, I mean, they still go to the Olympics with separate flags. They don't carry the EU flag, as it were, right? So I think that South Asian entity was a fabulous idea, but it hasn't again exactly panned out quite like that, because you need unity for that. So India and Pakistan had their issues, so there went South Asian unity, right? Then Pakistan, over time, tried to play Sri Lanka in many ways. There went South Asian unity. India has very special trade relationships with Nepal. For instance, Nepali goods could come in duty-free entirely into India. I eat Nepali instant noodles when I need to, for instance. But now they've raised duty, so there's a flap with Nepal. Another story. But there are this idea of South Asia has sort of fractured into bilateral or trilateral relationships, really, you know? So in a SAARC platform, Bhutan in the old days immediately was suspect because it was an ally of India. And India controlled or had a say over its foreign policy. So everybody else would say, I mean, you're really people accuse the UK of being America's lapdog right through the Gulf War, the second Gulf War and beyond. People would accuse Bhutan of being India's lapdog in the region. Bangladesh and India had its trouble. Sri Lanka and India has had a trouble. But it has, again, it enjoys a growing and increasing economic relationship, by the way. I mean, in Goa, in the shop that I go to purchase my groceries, you get Sri Lankan, made in Sri Lanka sausages, made in Sri Lanka tea, made in Sri Lanka biscuits. Small example, but everyday examples where you don't need grand constructs necessarily for one country to be identified in another country or be part of that country's life or economy or social fabric in many ways. But that pan-South Asian thing hasn't really gelled, my friend. And I'm brokenhearted because I'm a absolute optimist and a foolish idealist and a believer in the South Asian idea. I suspect that some of our neighbors may not be too averse to the idea of a common currency, because while we may be trading 57 or 58 to the Canadian dollar, I'm joking here, I'm being completely facetious, do not take me seriously. They might go for a sort of a monetary union. It will not happen. I'm just offering you hope, as I offer myself hope. And what has therefore happened is that Pakistan has actually forged pretty strong links with what we call the Stans, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, so on and so forth. India has forged leapfrog links with Southeast Asia. We have a very robust economic relationship with ASEAN. In fact, ASEAN has been pressing India to sort of open up a free trade agreement, broad-base it, going beyond the bilateral agreements that we have with several Southeast Asian countries. In fact, I think the Indian Foreign Office is freshly back from Brunei, where the ASEAN conference took place, and via Singapore, where all the heads of missions met, and to talk about how things could work with this region. So, ironically, when they floated this sort of SAARC, notion of SAARC, and the headquarters of the SAARC Secretariat, by the way, is in Kathmandu, for those of you who are interested. It hasn't really worked out like that. So we've broken up and formed our own little alliances wherever we found them, and I think that's the organic way to do things. What can I say?
And yes.
Bad economy globally.
Yes.
I mean, as we speak, I mean, the global economy is slowing down or slowed down. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
Well, it's cyclical. Economists in the audience? Any economists in the audience? Trade economists and so on and so forth. So, I mean, okay, the pat answer is that it's cyclical. What goes up comes down. What goes down tries to come up. Economic cycles and so on and so forth. I mean, if India is at a sort of a, finds it difficult to export its goods and invite, say, direct foreign investment into the country, then I think there are other countries, several other dozens of countries in the world, in Asia, in Southeast Asia, in Africa, which is really the big thing now, and parts of South America, these countries are facing, I mean, they're facing trouble as well to invite. And by the way, my friend, I think the notion of where money comes from and where money goes has begun to change somewhat. So we're not always looking at investment in India from North America. The Indian missions, this I know for a fact, that are very, I mean, have become increasingly more robust all across the globe. The economic aspect of the Indian diplomatic missions have become stronger in many ways. Indians are going out to many places to invest. I give you a few examples of Canada. If you look at this, the statistics of Indo-Canadian economic interaction, it's quite surprisingly robust. Several billions of dollars of mergers and acquisitions, investments have happened even under our very noses, perhaps, when we are consumed with saying, oh, India's too far away and India's not. I travel in New Delhi when I travel in the subway. I travel on a Bombardier train car. When I travel from Goa to Chennai, I travel on a Bombardier propeller jet, the Q4000. You know, these things are happening. So products are moving when they need to organically. This is in university, right? So this is like a classroom chat. I think this is like International Trade 101 or something. Or Global Investment 101. Investment and trade define their levels, like water does and like air will. And if there is a downturn, then some benefit from it, some energize themselves to work with the downturn and actually come out better and stronger and fitter. That too your professors will tell you, I think. So we go with the flow.
On that note, thank you very much for coming tonight. It's been a wonderful, invigorating conversation. And please do try to get out to some of the other events of the Indian Summer Festival. Sudeep, thank you so much for your time. Thank you. I know this was your first visit to Vancouver. Please,
my first visit to Canada. And I'm so happy that I'm in Vancouver, where even people who cross the streets wearing a suit, they amble. They amble across the zebra, and I love them.
You're in slacker's paradise. Thank you for coming, and thank you. Good night.
Thank you.